Previously, we talked about how electric charges can build up on surfaces and create something known as static electricity. In this episode, let's talk about what happens when these electric charges continuously move in a process known as current electricity. Most electronics, everything from your refrigerator to your smartphone, requires current electricity to operate. Let's assume that we have a copper wire that's filled with copper atoms. Copper is one of those elements that has only one electron in its outermost shell, which means that with only a little energy, that electron can be easily ejected. If we push a free electron into the copper wire, it will eventually find a new atom to latch onto. The negative charge of that electron will eject another electron from the outer shell, which will then move on to the next atom, and so on and so on. This chain of moving electrons creates a flow known as electric current. Some elements, like copper, aluminum, and gold, can move electrons easily and are known as conductors. We can look at moving charges in another way. Let's say that this tube is a conductive wire and the steel balls are negative electric charges, electrons in this case. We might think that one charged particle needs to move completely through the conductor to create a flow, but that's not actually the case. As we push a ball in one end, the force causes all the balls to move and one pops out the other end. As you can see, one electron, even if it doesn't move very far, can force all the other electrons to move, creating a flow. What we just showed was electric current, which is a flow of electric charge. In most circuits, this is accomplished by moving electrons. The unit for measuring current is the ampere, which is often abbreviated as amps and written with a capital A. 1 ampere is defined as 1 coulomb of charge moving past a point per second. Let's look at a cross-section of wire carrying an electric current. If it takes 3 seconds for 6 coulombs of charge to move through that cross-section, then we say that 2 amps are moving through that wire. Unfortunately, electric current doesn't just magically flow through wires. It needs a little help. If left alone, the electrons in a wire won't move. We need to give them a little push. To do that, we'll use a voltage source, like a battery. In a battery, there is a buildup of negative charge on one side in the form of excess electrons. The other side has a buildup of positive charge, an absence of electrons in this case. The charges want to balance out, but the only way to do that is for the excess electrons to flow around the battery through a conductor that we provide. If we connect a piece of wire to the negative terminal, the electrons will push against the electrons in the wire. However, air is an insulator, as its molecules do not have very mobile electrons, and it won't readily accept the free electrons. To show this, we'll put a piece of tape at the end of the tube. Now, the electrons at the end of the wire have nowhere to go. Even if we push against the electrons in the wire, they still won't budge. To fix this, we need to connect the other end of the wire to a place where the electrons want to go, and the positive end of the battery will happily accept the electrons. In fact, don't try this with a real battery. There is nothing slowing down or restricting the flow of electrons, which results in tremendous amounts of energy being transformed into heat in the wire, and this could easily melt the wire insulation or start a fire. This is known as a closed circuit, as it creates a loop from one side of the energy source to the other. If we break the wire or remove it from one of the terminals, then the electrons will stop flowing. This is known as an open circuit. We've been talking about electron flow in a circuit and showing how electrons move from the negative terminal to the positive terminal. However, in electronics, we usually assign current as flowing from positive to negative, or from higher potential to lower potential. This is known as conventional current. In the mid-1700s, Benjamin Franklin theorized that positively charged objects had an excess of what he called electric fluid, and that negatively charged objects had a deficit of this fluid. Franklin noted that this fluid had a tendency to flow from positive to negative to distribute itself more evenly. It wasn't until the end of the 19th century that English physicist J.J. Thomson discovered the existence of the electron. Even though we now know that it is electrons that move inside of most circuits from low to high potential, the convention of current moving from high to low potential stuck. As a result, most current measurements are given as conventional current, which is the movement of positive charge in a circuit, and is represented by the capital letter I. Don't worry, the math still works out as long as we stick with either electron flow or conventional current. And since most electronics textbooks use conventional current, we'll go with that. We talked about making electricity do work for us, and the circuit forms the basis for all modern electronics, everything from the simple flashlight to massive supercomputers. If we made a circuit out of just a battery and a piece of wire, there's a chance we might melt that wire as the electrons move through that wire at an alarming rate and generate massive amounts of heat. In the next episode, we'll talk about the relationship between voltage and current and introduce the resistor.